everyone, and welcome to Thorough Newspaper Analysis, which is brought to you by Losico. So today we have two articles to be discussed. Both are from The Hindu. The first one is Defending Liberty Against Political Prosecution. So this article basically discusses about what do we mean by selective prosecution and how has it been a lot into trend these days and what are the repercussions of it on the justice system in the country. And secondly, a case to dispose of mercy petition swiftly. So as the name itself is suggesting very much, that it discusses about limiting the time period for the president to consider the mercy petitions and how this lethargy or pendency leads to violation of justice and human rights has been discussed in this article. So if you're also preparing for judicial services examination, you can have a look at the Lord of the Courses, which is Judiciary Test Prep course coming from Losico. The link to this course is available in the description box below. And from the landing page, you can also download free study material for your own preparation. We're also excelling into courses like for CLAT, All India Bar Exam, SEBI, etc. You can have a look at them too. So this is the multiple choice question from yesterday's discussion. Which of the following states has been declared the best performer in the second India Innovation Index by Niti Aayog? Your options are Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, or Maharashtra. You can write down your answer in the comment section below. This is the descriptive question for the day. Should capital punishment be abolished in India? Critically discuss. So as I said, whenever there is critically discuss, you have to write both the positive sides of the argument and also the negative side of the argument. That is, you have to give a balanced discussion. So in the first article, let's discuss about the selective prosecution. So firstly, why actually this entire thing is in news is because the Supreme Court in the case of Arnab Goswami's bail petition strengthened the recognition and use of selective prosecution claim in India to counter politically colored prosecution. For this, firstly, we need to understand as to what do we mean by selective prosecution. So it is one of the oldest, most pernicious and widespread forms of abuse of the state power in India. It involves the police and enforcement agencies selectively targeting the politicians, the politica and ideological opponents of the ruling dispensation. So basically what happens is that whenever there is any person who is probably not in the support of the current political regime, whatever is going on, or he is some kind of an ideological opponent of the ruling party or something, so then that person is actually, the state, by using its, or basically we can call that by misusing its power, they get them prosecuted. So they get them arrested into some false cases and similar stuff. So that basically is known as selective prosecution. So all in all, it is that whenever there is any kind of illegal prosecution on the grounds which are actually prohibited by the Constitution, that is considered to be as a selective prosecution. So it is not a defense on the merits to the criminal charge itself, but an independent assertion that the prosecutor has brought the charge for reasons forbidden by the Constitution. So it is forbidden by Article 14 of the Indian Constitution because we have equal protection of law. And in that sense, it is a duty of the state to give equal protection to every citizen of the country, everyone in the country. But selective prosecution violates the Article 14 of right to equality of the people who are prosecuted under any such kind of frivolous charges. So it is to punish some persons for what is permitted to the others as lawful without any distinction of circumstances is an unjust and illegal discrimination. So it is like an act which is actually allowed for the others who could be the members of the ruling party or and the similar ideology people. But for the very similar act, another person is prosecuted because he is not ideologically supporting the idea of the ruling party or the party or any authority in power. So the court held that courts should be alive to the need of ensuring the law does not become a ruse of targeted harassment. The doors of this court cannot be closed to a citizen who is able to establish prima facie that the instrumentality of the state is being weaponized for using the force of criminal law. So basically, in no way the courts should allow that the state or the power in or the state in power or the authority in power is able to misuse any kind of its power to put up any kind of frivolous or misuse any power against any kind of individual. So it was quoted in the case of Romila Thapar versus Union of India in 2018. that the basic entitlement of every citizen who is faced with allegation of criminal wrongdoing is that the investigative process should be fair. So this is very, very important that irrespective of the fact that whether this person is really the accused or has he really done something wrong or not, irrespective of the fact, the investigation of every trial should be very, very fair, and we should make sure that no any kind of jeopardy or no, there is no other kind of, you know, frivolous activity that takes place in the prosecution or in the investigative process. So what is the stand of the Indian courts on selective prosecution? So I have not recognized selective prosecution as an independent claim because of the erroneous assumption that the lawfulness of prosecution can only be taken up after the trial. So, you know, in India, what do we consider is that it is only after the trial that we'll be able to understand whether the trial or the prosecution was lawful or not. But then again, if at all, for example, let's say a person was under some kind of frivolous or malicious trial, and he was under this process for 2 whole years. So according to the current system that we have in India, it would only be after these 2 years that a decision could be arrived upon that whether or not this prosecution was right or wrong on this person. But what about these 2 years that have completely been wasted of that particular person? So that definitely is not good. And according to the 2018 report of the Law Commission on wrongful prosecution, miscarriage of justice, legal remedies, it said that the remedies for wrongful prosecution are available only if and after the accused is acquitted, which is definitely not something good because the time period which it took to acquit this particular person is also very long, specifically if you talk about in the judicial system of our own country. And that is why it is very much, it violates the fundamental rights of this particular person who was prosecuted. So for other comments, the remedy after acquittal comes far too late. Yes, it does. Then the right against selective prosecution cannot be extinguished by conviction. So basically, it just says that if there is any selective prosecution going on a particular person, so we say that if he is not convicted, so it means that he is all, it was all right. And then we consider that we do not really take into account the time and efforts and energy and money that had been wasted for this particular person. And thus, just not being convicted cannot be the only right that is available in case of selective prosecution, and other remedies should also be available. Then the claim of selective prosecution is a threshold issue that is required to be adjudicated at the outset of criminal proceedings, irrespective of the merit of the charges. And thus we have, in the IPC also, we have this provision for malicious prosecution. That is, in the torts, law of torts also, we have malicious prosecution, but it should be made more firm and formalized. With this, let's discuss the second article for the day, which talks about the death row convicts. Recently, Balwant Singh Rajona, who was the former Punjab Chief Minister Beant Singh's assassin, who actually had assassinated Beant Singh, who was the former CM of Punjab, was pardoned in principal commute by the president in 2019. So it was done as a humanitarian gesture ahead of the 550th birth anniversary celebrations of Guru Nanak Dev. And after Rajona was incarcerated for over 25 years. Now, this is the very thing that we need to consider, that though a commutation was given to him for his death sentence, but the case, that is, he was under the trial, he was in the prison for over 25 years, which means that the request for commutation or for reducing the death penalty was actually, it was pending for such long time. So if we talk about abolishing capital punishment, so there are reasons to review India's position on capital punishment. Firstly, delay in carrying out the death penalty. Now, a very, very good example, which all of us know about, was of the Nirbhaya case convict. So of the Nirbhaya rape convict, the actual incident took place in 2012, and it was just previous year in 2020 when they were given the executed. They were actually executed. It was after a pendency of 8 long years. So we can see that in the death penalty cases, there is huge delay that goes on. And then 2015 Law Commission of India report proposed abolishing. Now you can note down these points as to whenever there is a question upon death penalty or abolition of capital punishment, you can quote. These are so authentic sources that you can quote. So that the 2015 Law Commission of India report proposed abolishing the death penalty and sought comments of states and union territories on the subject. But out of them, only 14 states and 12 rejected the proposal, while Karnataka and Tripura concurred. So only 14 states had responded and the others have not responded even till 2018. So around 142 countries in the world have abolished death penalty, and India still is amongst 50 or 60 countries that has not abolished capital punishment till date. So here is a small data on the executions by the Amnesty International. So thousands of Chinese are executed every year, classified as secret information. And in 2018, Iran executed 253 convicts and Saudi Arabia executed 149. And total number of executions have actually in total reduced from 993 in 2017 to 690 in 2018. You don't really need to remember them, you know, term by term, word by word, or complete facts, just the trend you should be able to understand. Then if we talk particularly about India, in 2019, 102 convicts were awarded death sentence, and the total prisoners who are in the death row are 378. An average 25 years of imprisonment is taken up by every individual or every convict for the death sentence. Then this was something to be applauded, that Pranab Mukherjee, in his tenure of presidentship, disposed 34 mercy petitions and pardoned 4 amongst them. And we need to fix a time for we need to fix a time frame, because even today till now, there is no time set or complete time frame under which the president has to decide upon the pendency of the death sentence cases, which actually mercy petition cases that come to him or her. But there should be a fixed time frame so that there is no lethargy and there is no pendency in the death row convicts. So this was all for the day. We hope it was a good session for you. If in case you wish to download the PDF for today's slides, you can join our Telegram group, the link to which is there in the description box below. And you can also visit our official website for any other information. Thank you so much.